man. I love you too. Thank you so much. Amazing. Thank you very much. Wow. Why don't you stay standing just for a minute? Hello, Hope and Life. Don't you love a conference that's just called Hope and Life? I mean, like, that's the message before the message. And I'm so thrilled to be here. The only downside of how excited I am about being here tonight is I really wish I'd been here last night to hear the message that kicked off the conference. And so that was kind of sad. I wish that I'd been able to be a part of that. I heard so many great things about it. And I really wish I could be here tomorrow night because I hear Mike Todd's going to be here tomorrow night. I mean, if I'm to say that or not, I don't know. I just deduced that and did the math on my own. And so I kind of am excited to be here tonight, but I really wish I was here last night or tomorrow night. But I'm still happy to be here tonight, and I know you're going to be really blessed all the way through this time. I want to just honor the team of people who made it possible for all of us to be here. I like it. We're going to honor them. We haven't even said anything yet. That's awesome. It's free. That's all you get for it's free? Yeah. What do you go to that's free, that's good? Like nothing. So that's amazing. And I just want to honor Pastor Joel and Victoria. And I want to honor Miss Doty, who's right here and who is a legend and amazing. And Nick and Summer, who had the vision to make all this happen and paved the way. It's just beautiful to see, and I'm so honored to be back. And it wasn't too shabby having Tarn Wells and the Lakewood team lead out tonight. Not too bad. The pants on point. The whole team is on point. Can we just thank them for the way they led us tonight? And well, come on, can we just give some thanks to these guys, the way they led and paved the way for us tonight? So powerful and amazing. I believe tonight is going to be a game changer. I did not come here tonight just to give a talk and do a thing. I came here to be vulnerable, and so I'm going to do that in the middle of this message, and I'm going to kind of get off the platform level and let you have a peek into my real life, because my real life has had some peaks and some valleys in it. Some highs and some lows. And when I talk about being free tonight, I'm not talking as a preacher. I'm talking as a human being who's been down in the darkness. And it's a miracle that I'm actually here tonight and in this place by the grace of God, being able to do the thing that God created me to do. But I really do believe that God can breathe into the theme of this conference, which is peace is power. It's possible that whatever's been dominating you, and I know, you know, generally speaking what it is, it's the spirit of fear and all of its cousins. You want to name them all? Anxiety is a cousin. Depression is a cousin. Dread, doom, worry, stress. Probably none of you dealing with any of those cousins, but they're all connected to the spirit of fear. But God's word says that when we get saved, something powerful and revolutionary happens. I'm not preaching yet. We're going to sit down a minute. Then I'm going to start preaching. But I wanted to say something before I start preaching. That when we get saved, we don't just get a pass into heaven. We don't just join something or believe something or attend something. When we get saved, a revolution happens on the inside of us. The Spirit of God comes into our spirit and awakens us as brand new people. And here's what the Bible says about that. It says, and the Spirit of Christ, when that Spirit came into you, did not make you a slave again to fear. Instead, that Spirit cried out of your heart, Abba, Father. And the Spirit of Christ testifies with our spirit, listen to this, that we are God's children. And do not yawn on that tonight. Do not give me some old-time stale church response to that tonight. Oh, we're children of God. Isn't that great? We've heard that all of our lives. No, it is a revival that happened inside of us. And the Spirit of Christ wants to crush the spirit of fear, set you free from being a slave to that spirit and all of its cousins. And the Spirit of God does that by affirming in your spirit that you are God's child and that the Father that is your Father is the God of all creation. And if God can do that tonight, A, you're going to know you're saved. People ask me that all the time. How can I know that I'm saved? Have you ever wondered that question? Like, how do I really know that I'm saved? Like, I didn't just pray the prayer, go through the motions. How do I know that it really took and I'm really saved? You know you're saved when the Spirit of God cries out of your spirit, God is my Father. That's how you know you're saved. So if your spirit hasn't ever said, you're my Father and I'm your daughter, then you might need to get saved tonight. Because that's what happens when we put our faith in Jesus. So we're going to pray that the spirit of anxiety will be crushed in this next few minutes in this room. And a culture that basically put another seat at the table and just said, yeah, that's anxiety. We all have it. We all deal with it. We're all being medicated because of it. And it's just a thing now. You know, we're the anxious generation. No, no, no. We are the sons and daughters of Almighty God. That's who we are. And we're going to pray toward that end right now. So if you believe that tonight, can you just open your hands to God as if you really want God to speak that power and move in that kind of truth in your life tonight? Father, we ask you in the name of Jesus that you would move through this place tonight and touch every life with the full power that raised Jesus from the dead. You said the same spirit that raised Christ up from the dead lives in us. So I ask you to do the miraculous and the supernatural tonight, that we would walk out of these doors with a new mindset, that we are no longer slaves again to fear. But we cry out, Abba, Father. I ask that you would destroy the works of the enemy that are choking the very life out of your children and out of this generation. And that you will set us free tonight. I pray that somebody will be yelling at the top of their lungs before this night is over. God has set me free. And we believe for that in the name, the power, the authority, and the blood of Jesus Christ. And everybody says, amen. 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 You can have a seat, and on the way down, just tell your neighbor, I do believe that something great is about to happen. I want to take us tonight to a text that I'm a little nervous about. Because when I take us to this text, you're going to go, oh, I know this one. And you might miss the whole night. I'm going to take us to the most famous passage of Scripture in the Bible. That's just my opinion. You may disagree. What do you think is the most famous passage of Scripture in the Bible? John 3:16. That's the number one answer. But I don't believe that's the answer. That's the number one thing you see at a sporting event. But in every movie that's ever been made, if someone gets married or somebody dies, you're going to hear this passage of Scripture. You know what it is? The 23rd Psalm. And I want to take us there. But before we get there, I'm going to pray for a miracle. I'm going to just tell you what it is. I'm praying for it as I tell you. I'm praying that God will shift us out of the cobwebs of being in church too long. Because when I say Psalm 23, you're saying, the Lord is my shepherd, say it with me, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the... rod and your staff, they comfort me. Before me in the presence of enemy, to anoint my head with oil, my cup runs over. And what you're thinking is, yeah, my grandma has that in needlepoint on the dining room wall. But that's not relevant to 2019 culture. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And I want to blow that up for a moment. And I want you to think about what God is offering you. Now, this isn't us tonight. The church is always a we, but I want you to get this super personal tonight, and I want you to think about what God Almighty is putting on the table. I, Jesus is saying, want to be your shepherd. Now, the choice of whether I am or not is going to be up to you, but I want to be your shepherd. Now, that you're not going to have an option tonight that says, I don't want a shepherd. Now, you're going to have a shepherd because you were created to be led, and something is going to lead you. The culture is going to lead you. The anthem of the world's going to lead you. You're going to get on your horse and ride up to the Old Town Road, and that's going to lead you. You're going to go with whatever the Instagram flow is. It's going to lead you. You're going to be your shepherd. A lot of you are like, I don't have a shepherd. I run the show here. I call the shots. I decide everything. Great. Then you're your shepherd. So your psalm goes, I am my shepherd, and therefore I am a mess. I am jacked up. I wouldn't know still water if it was staring right at me. I haven't laid it down in a green pasture in a while. And my soul, not great. But Jesus is in the mix tonight. And he's offering to be your shepherd. Like, I will lead you. I will be there. I will plow the ground. I will be day and night. I will take care of you and watch over you and guide you and protect you and ensure for you that surely goodness and love are going to follow you every day. And I promise you, if I lead you, you're going to end up dwelling in the house of God forever. And I promise you, if you let me lead you, you are not going to be in want. I think this is the most under-accessed promise in the Bible. And Jesus is stepping into a stressed-out culture and saying, I'd love to lead you. Now, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to make you do something. You're like, oh, no, I'm getting off right here. Nobody's making me do anything. The very first thing he says is, I'm going to make you lie down in green pasture. We're not preaching on that tonight, so I'll leave it by the wayside. But we're so dumb. And I know I don't mean dumb. I don't mean like you're dumb. I just mean when God says we're sheep, he's not paying us a big compliment. He's got, oh, you're so woolly and so cute and so amazing and incredible. When he's calling us sheep, he's saying, you don't see good. And you're not a uber high intellect when it comes to making good decisions about your well-being. You know why he leads them by the gentle brook? Because the sheep is so dumb that if a sheep sees a roaring stream going by and it's thirsty, it says, oh man, I am thirsty. Look at that. Yeah. Now, the sheep doesn't know it's covered with like 7 duvets. That's like a big blanket in case somebody lost me right there. Look, duvets, bro, I don't know. I don't speak French. And the sheep goes, yeah, I'm getting some of that. Puts its head in, and all its wool gets wet and pulls it into the river. And now the sheep is headed toward the rapids, looking back to see if shepherd is nearby. And shepherd could come running in with the crook, pull it to the side, grab it by the wool, and get it out. That's what God's dealing with. Can you embrace it? Or are you fighting it? Are you still fighting it? Or are you embracing it? Who's embracing it? I'm prone to stick my head in running water and end up in a rapid because I'm not of high intelligence when it comes to making good decisions about my well-being. I need a shepherd who knows how to say, no, we're not drinking here. We're not going to go up to the edge of Niagara Falls and drink. We're going to go over here to this little bitty quiet tributary where it's about an inch deep. Everybody this way. Voila. Drink up and live. So God starts off by saying, I want to make you lie down. We might should preach a message on it because I kind of am when I said I wasn't, but if you don't know how to lie down, God will make you lie down. Not because he's against you, but because he's for you. Remember that time you had your ACL thing and you were out for like 6 weeks? Could have been. I'm not saying God did your ACL thing, but maybe he was just like working through all the events of life to say, you need to lay down for a little while. He says, I want to make you do something. I'm going to lead you. I'm going to restore you. I'm going to guide you. And even if you're in the valley of the shadow of death, I'm going to be with you. This is what the message was last night that was so powerful. Not that peace comes in the absence of problems and pain, but peace comes with the presence of a God who says, I'll be with you in the midst of a broken world. But then this next verse is a crazy verse. This verse to me, I've looked at it for a long time in my life and I went, surely there's a misprint going on here. It says in verse 5, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Now, I'm sure if I wrote that, which I didn't, I would have written it this way. God, if you're going to prepare a table, that's awesome, but I think the verse really needs to read this way. You prepare a table before me in your presence. Smoke the enemies. And prepare a table in your presence. Na 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 na. Na 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 na. And now I'm in the presence of God at my table. That's not what it says. There is something so powerful in this tonight, and I hope that we see it. God says, I'm going to prepare a table before you, and I'm going to do it right in the middle of the conflict. I'm going to prepare the table in the middle of the chemo ward. In the middle of your family cracking up, in the middle of the stress, in the middle of the circumstance, in the middle of the difficulty, in the middle of whatever you're fighting against, externally or internally, I'm putting the table right in the middle of all of it. And if we can see that tonight, something really, really powerful will happen. Let me kind of break this down for us in a way that I think we'll remember better than just seeing it on the page. It's as if God Almighty said to you, I prepared a table for two. Now that's awfully close to you. Now you've been eyeing that Danish roll for a minute. And I respect your restraint. But it might pay off good for you in a minute. I want to prepare a table for you in the presence. I'm not saying you're my enemy, but you are right now. And you are, and you are, and you are, and you are. You are my troubles, and my problems, and my stressor. You are trying to stab me in the back. You're saying things about me that aren't true. You're trying to cut me. And right in the middle of it, the God of heaven said, Louie, have a seat. I prepared a table for you. Can you imagine this? God Almighty, have a seat. Are you thirsty? Let me get you some water. Ooh, I can do it like the waiter at the restaurant. Yeah. Amazing. I'll have some too, although I'm not thirsty because I am the living water.
No, don't clap for that. That was terrible.
Would you like? I have a little charcuterie sampler. It's meat and cheese, bro. Would you like some fruit? A, God's not chintzy. Hi. Have a grape. No, he's like, let's eat. And it's a table for two. What does this mean? It means that God wants an intimate relationship with you. He wants a relationship with you, and he doesn't promise to minimize your enemies. He doesn't promise to wipe out your enemies. He just promises to put a table for you in the presence of your enemies. A table for two. And the most powerful thing about it, because you're like, what's on the table? You know, I mean, what is all that stuff? And the thing about it is, it's not about what's on the table. It's about who's at the table. I'm like, oh, I like that God isn't on the whole 30. Praise God. I knew he would come through for me. But it's not about what God gave me. It's about that God wants to sit with me. But here's the weird part. Here's the crazy thing. No, it's not often you eat a carrot and a Danish at the same time, but it's pretty good. Try again. The crunch, the sweet. Very good. I feel good. I feel bad. Crazy part is how quick the enemy can pull up a chair at your table. My wife and I, Shelly, she's amazing for having a meal for her birthday in another country. And we were at a four-top table. And it's one of her favorite restaurants. We planned it ahead. It just so happened we were in that city, in that country, on her birthday. We're having a meal. A few people get up from another table and go out. And I want to tell this story you're going to feel bad about for this guy, but don't, because I'm not a jerk. Just telling you what happened. And these people came by, and this young man walked by, and he did a double take, and then a triple take, and then he turned around and came back, and he said, are you Louie Giglio? And I said, I am. He was shocked to see me out of the country and having a nice meal. And he said, this is crazy. I was at XYZ conference you spoke at 2 months ago, and ever since that conference, I believe that the Lord wanted me to have a conversation with you and share something with you. And it's just crazy that here you are. And I said, well, that's great, man. Thank you for saying that. And I'm so glad that God spoke to you. And that encourages both of us. And he said, yeah, man, just great to see you. And he went on out. And I said to Shelly, well, like I always do, I said, you know, our life is so amazing. God uses us. We're in a story. And about 3 minutes later, guy comes back in. And I thought, well, maybe he left his sunglasses or his wallet. No. And so he comes in and he says, you know, we got outside and my friend said, it's got to be the Lord. That it's got to be the Lord. You need to go talk to him right now. This is the moment. So he comes up to the table, which has got two empty chairs, and he pulls a chair out and he says, you know what? My friend just told me that this is probably the Lord wanting me to join you tonight and tell you about. Now he's got his hand on the chair. Is anybody nervous beside me? I'm a little bit nervous right now. And wanted me to join you and talk to you about my vision. And I quickly said, because I was trying to defer and deflect, I said, oh, it would be great, except that it's my wife's birthday. Now, does anybody get that? Am I a jerk? Wait till you see what happens next and then tell me. No, I'm just kidding. Man, you're really close. would you like something to eat or a snack of any kind? No, just very, very polite. No, I don't want your cheese. Here, just have a Triscuit, please. Just no. Oh, thank you. That makes me feel better. Yay. And so I said, it's my wife's birthday. And he said, oh, happy birthday. And then he said, anyway, so. And that's when I went out of the spirit into the flesh. And I was like, And I just kind of looked at him like, don't sit all the way down. And he kind of looked at me like, don't sit all the way down. Don't sit all the way down. Like, not staying? No, not staying. We're not going to have our moment? Not tonight. And he got up and kind of slowly walked away, and he was very disappointed. And if you're here tonight, I love you. And I'm sorry. But just like that, if you're not careful, the enemy is at your table. Table for two, he just pulls a chair up. Man, this is amazing. Do you mind if I get one of these, this brownie thing? No? Awesome. Thank you so much. Do you mind if I borrow your napkin just for a second? Thank you so much. Anyway, how you doing? You good? I'm thinking with your mom. She's still crazy? I don't know how you do it. I'm a psycho. I'm sorry your parents split up. What? It's not your fault. Not your fault. No. I know. Your dad's got other family in Arizona, but that's not your fault. You sleeping good? And I mean like that. He is sitting at your table, eating your food. And all up in your grill. God prepared the table, but the enemy, man, in a heartbeat. Might have had some cheese. Thank you. Been really tough lately, hasn't it? I know. I don't know. I don't know if we're going to make it. Think about just maybe bailing out. Might not be a bad idea. Like, how would I know if the enemy is at my table? Number one, and we'll go super fast. The enemy is at your table if there's a voice in your head telling you it's better at another table. Yeah. So looking at John chapter 10, and this is what it says. A verse that everyone in this building probably has heard before. The enemy or the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I've come that they might have life and have it to the full. So if there's a voice telling you, hey, you need to run with this other crowd. You need to hang with this other group. If you're here and you're married, hey, you need to think about that other chick or that other guy. There's another place for you where there's more life and more food and more fun and more of what you're looking for. If you're hearing that today, plain and simple, the enemy is at your table. I'll tell you a second way you know. If you've heard a voice in your mind, in your heart, in your head, that's telling you, you're not gonna make it. The enemy is at your table. Because your God, your shepherd, who prepared this table for you, has just told you, even though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, fear no evil. Not walk to the valley. No, you're going through the valley. So if any voice comes into your life and says, you're not going to get over this, You're never going to make it through this. This is never going to work out. You're never going to be the same again. You might as well lower your expectations and just deal with what is. That is a sign that the enemy is at your table and you are having a conversation with a killer. I'll tell you another way you know that the enemy's at your table. If there's a voice in your head, and it is crazy to think about it in a beautiful gathering like this, looking around this amazing conference, but if the voice in your head is telling you right now that you're not good enough, or to put it simply the way a lot of people in our generation feel it, you're not enough, and you never will be, the enemy is at your table. Jesus went on to say, after he said the thief comes to steal and kill, he said, I am the good shepherd, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Do you realize that you actually are so prized that the shepherd would pay with his life to invite you to this table as a son or daughter of a king? And when you sit at this table, you have to know that I am worth Jesus to God. I am a somebody. I am not incidental or accidental. I actually am created and miraculous and loved and prized and sought for and fought for and bought by the God of heaven. And any other voice, you're not pretty enough, you're not smart enough, you didn't come from the right family, you'll never be a good father, you'll never find a good wife, you'll never measure up, you'll never make it, you're not enough. That voice is a sign that the enemy is at your table. And here's the message God wants you to hear tonight. The scripture says that Satan prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. And we can't stop him from doing that. The scripture doesn't imply anywhere that we can keep the enemy from prowling around seeking someone to devour. But here's the key. We can keep him from sitting down at our table. I want to tell you about the text that might have saved my life. A few years ago, I was going through a really hard time. This is after falling into a hole of anxiety and depression that knocked me out of commission for 4 or 5 months of my life. I'm talking about I didn't go out of the house, didn't go to work, didn't go to dinner with friends, didn't go for a walk in the cul-de-sac with my wife. Way down in a pit of darkness and depression and anxiety, crippled by all that. And then a few years later, come through a really, really difficult season in life where there are a lot of darts coming my way. And in the middle of it all, surrounded by a lot of half-truth and just a lot of angst coming, I reached out to a friend of mine who I knew had my back. Do you have that friend? And I texted him a super long text, like this long. All my woes. Man, can you believe so-and-so-and-so-and-so and blah, 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 and isn't this crazy and blah, 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 and you know my heart and I da 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 da. Now, I'm not in your generation, so this text took me approximately 45 minutes to construct. I sent it, and it was one of those kind of texts where you don't put the phone down and wait for it to buzz. You just stare at it till you get something back. You ever sent one of those? Like, hit me back. And don't hit me back with an emoji. I know that's an impossible thought to some of you. But when you type a 45-minute come and get me text, you do not want a fist bump. You want a commensurate and appropriate amount of words coming back. At least as many as you sent, if not more. So I waited. Fortunately, my friend was near their phone, and the little wheel started turning. And I said, come on. Come on, get my back. Come on, stand with me. Come on, let's do this together. And when I saw the text come back, I was sure that he had hit sin too early. You know how you do that sometimes? Like you're flying along and you hit sin, but you were in the middle of a sentence, so you got to pick back up and go again. I'm sure that's what happened, because when I looked at it, it was way too short. And so I didn't even read it. I just said, I'm going to wait till the rest of it comes. And I waited, and the wheel stopped turning. I was like, And I looked down, and there were 9 words. 9 words. You still holding that Triscuit? It's down in your seat. Yeah, I knew you weren't going to eat it. You don't have, you want to keep it? Okay. Well, don't eat it, because you put it down on that seat cushion and someone's bottom has sat on that every Sunday for a long time. 9 words. But the 9 words ended up changing my life. And here are the 9 words. Don't give the enemy a seat at your table. My friend was smart enough to understand that when you're surrounded by a struggle or a circumstance or a challenge, you don't need somebody to speak back in and go, don't you worry, I got your back. Because come on, let's face it, maybe Lauren does have your back. But what is Lauren, like 5'8"? So if there's a major attack coming on your life, Lauren might not be your best hope. You need to know that someone greater has your back. And you need to know that the someone greater is actually sitting with you in the middle of the circumstance, encouraging you, speaking truth to you, and giving you the power over your table. So you say to the enemy, you may prowl around, but you may not sit down at this table. You may not join this table. Your voice is not welcome at this table. Your opinion is not welcome at this table. This opinion is welcome at this table. His voice is the voice that leads me. My shepherd leads me, and that's how I don't have any wants. And I just want to encourage you tonight, some of you need to take authority over your table tonight. And hear the power of these words. Don't give the enemy a seat at your table. And I would guess 1,000 times since this moment 5 or 6 years ago, I will be in a situation and those words will rise back up in my heart. Whoa, 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 whoa. I am giving the enemy a voice. I am giving the enemy a chance to pitch in. I'm giving the enemy a vote. I'm giving the enemy a place. I'm giving the enemy a seat. And I just stop and say, look, I'm not dealing with you. I'm not talking to you. I'm not listening to you. I don't belong to you. And you don't get a seat at my table. I am sitting with the King. I am sitting with the Almighty. I am sitting with the Maker of heaven and earth. I am sitting with a God who's already given his very best for me, and I believe in his goodness, and I believe in who he is in my life. And I'm going to lock my eyes on him. And why in the presence of the enemies? I love this. It's so that whatever's coming against you and whoever's coming against you has to sit there and watch you have a meal with the Almighty God. And that's a game changer. God put the table in the presence of the enemy so the enemies could see what it looks like when someone sits in the presence of a king. The scripture says, we look to you and our faces are radiant. Don't you know that just disturbs the darkness more than anything when they're pressing in and attacking and trying to sow seeds of doubt and conflict and undermine what God says is true about you? And you're just locked on your king and you're like, this is the greatest thing of all time. I love being with you. I love your truth. I love who you are and who you say I am. This is beautiful and amazing. And what it does is it frees us. It frees us because all of a sudden we're not in a defensive posture like people are against me. So I'm walking through school and walking through the office going, I know she hates me. Look at them. They hate me. Look at him. He wants me to die. Look at him. He wants me to never see me again. Oh, these people, those people. Oh, look at her again. She didn't even look up when I came in today. Did you notice that? She didn't even say hello to me today. She hates me. He hates me. They're against me. They're trying to get rid of me. And we go into life with a defensive posture. You ever had that before? Like, I'm gonna get you before you get me. Always looking over my shoulder. But when you get the power of this, you're just walking around. Hey, how you doing? Can I offer you a brownie? Please, no, take a brownie. Here, take my napkin. Please, please, take a brownie. Share it with that young man right there. His eyes are getting bigger by the moment. Would you like a cookie? Please. Of course you would. Everybody would like a cookie. Hi. Here. Oh, isn't that so nice? He's going to share the cookie with you. This guy was really all up in my grill, but I'd like you to have whatever you'd like. Please, have something. Please, pass it down. No, take the whole tray. I have more where that came from. I've got enough on my table. I have a king at my table. I'm not walking around looking to punch somebody out. I'm walking around just blessing people and just speaking life over people and just letting people know that my God is enough for me. My God is enough for me, and I got enough with my God that I can just pass on the blessings of my God to everybody else and know that I'm always gonna have what I need because my God prepared a table before me right in the middle of the conflict. Oh, come on, Hope in Life. Do you believe that God has prepared for you everything that you need? And do you believe tonight that you have the authority to say out of your own heart, the enemy does not get a seat at my table? Do you believe you've got that authority? So I just want to invite, a lot of us are already standing, but I want to invite anybody in this place who's saying, you know what, anxiety? I just gave anxiety a chair. I just gave fear a seat, and I just deal with it. Yeah, fear's at the table. Worries at the table. Dread is at the table. Stress, yeah, you know, I'm just kind of stressed right now. Gave stress a seat at the table. Fear of the past, fear of the present, fear of what may come. And anxiety is choking the life out of a son of a king. Choking the life out of a son of Almighty God. Choking the life out of a daughter prized by the great I am. And God just wants to speak life over you and speak freedom over you. He can prowl around, but he cannot sit down. So we're going to pray together. And I want to pray for anybody in this place that's believing God for the reality of this table. Who wants to come back to intimacy with the king tonight. Who wants to have their eyes opened all over again to the beauty that it's not a table in God's presence. It's God at a table in the presence of whatever. That's what changes everything. So, Father, I pray that you're just touching hearts and lives. If that's you tonight and anxiety's had a grip, fear has had a grip, the lack of peace has been your story. But yet somehow your eyes are open tonight by the grace of God to see all over again that God is with you in the midst of it. And that's where the power and the truth is that sets you free. And I want to just ask you to lift your hand. I want to pray for you tonight. Anxiety's had a seat for too long. Fear's had a seat for too long. And I know these things are real. Trust me. Depression is real. It can kill you. Anxiety is real. It can take you out. I understand. It almost took me out. But I want to say tonight, it is not greater than your shepherd. And his rod and his staff, they comfort you. That means he's got a crook to guide you and a rod to protect you. And God has got your back. Father, I pray over every person tonight who's reaching with faith to believe that you are a good shepherd and is saying in their heart, I want you to lead me. I want you to make me. I want you to guide me. I want you to walk beside me. I want you to protect me, and I want you to prepare and provide for me. I want you to anoint me. I want you to follow me. I want you, Jesus. Not anxiety, not fear. I want you to be the shepherd of my heart. And I will look up to you through the day and through the night and say, my shepherd has got me. He's big enough to protect me. And he will provide for me even in the middle of the fight. And just like Summer shared tonight, Lord, that beautiful passage. While it may look like I'm surrounded, we believe and know that the God of heaven surrounds what surrounds us tonight. And we're sitting in the middle of the safety net of the King of Kings and the Prince of Peace. Let peace reign and break the yoke of fear. Let the Prince of Peace reign and break the curse of fear. This is our prayer, and we believe it, and we thank you for it in the name and the power of Jesus Christ. And everybody who's believing that for your life, just say amen.